fighting soldiers from the sky. Fearless men who jump and die. Men who mean just what they say. The brave men of the Green Beret.
All right, 20 minutes before 10 o'clock when I was 11 years old, that song was a hit. I do remember hearing it. I had no clue about the story behind the man who did it, though, and we're going to find out a little bit about that right now. The singer, the writer is Staff Sergeant Barry Sadler. He died, I think, in 1989, and there's some interesting circumstances behind not only the story of his life, but also the story of his death. Mark Leibson is on the phone. He wrote the book called Ballad of the Green Beret, The Life and Wars of Staff Sergeant Barry Sadler, From the Vietnam War and Pop Stardom to Murder and an Unsolved Violent Death. Mark, by the way, served also with the Army in Vietnam. He's a journalist and historian, a much accomplished journalist, I should say. He's an arts editor, a senior editor. Let me give you some credentials. Encyclopedia Britannica. That's all you need right there. Smithsonian, USA Today, The Today Show, MSNBC, CNN, etc., etc. It's an honor to have him on our show right here. Mark Leibson, good morning, sir. How are you?
Good morning, Larry. Thanks for having me on.
Where are you? Where are you calling from?
I live in Virginia near Washington, D.C.
Did you happen to know Barry Sadler?
No, I did not know him. I mean, I was, you know, in college when that song hit. Like you, that's the only thing I knew about the guy, actually. You know, that he had, it was the number one song of the year of 1966. It sold 9 million copies.
Wow.
And, you know, a year when the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and the Mamas and Papas and Simon and Garfunkel were popular. So he created quite a sensation.
Yeah. And as a kid, I don't remember it seeming out of place. I remember listening to the radio. I was big with radio. I love radio. And even at 11, I was, but it didn't seem out of place. It seemed like it fit in. It was just a good song.
That's right. And the other thing, you know, people think of the 60s, quote unquote, you know, massive anti-war movement, etc., which is true, but this song came out in January of 66 when the country, there was an anti-war movement, it was just getting started, and the country was in favor of the war in Vietnam. We backed it, so it came out at the right time. Somebody said he was the right guy for the right, with the right song at the right time.
Well, that's good, because the general sentiment is that we were not kind to you Vietnam veterans, which I know is true for the most part. And we've tried to make amends for that mistake in the years that have passed. But it is interesting that in 1966, this was a hit song.
Yeah. Well, when the war, you know, turned really controversial and then the news was bad, for some reason, the American public, and I don't mean just the anti-war movement, even the people, the war hawks, blamed us, you know, the guys who fought there.
Yes.
So when we came home, it was a shameful thing, like you said. I mean, we were really... You know, to oversimplify, I mean, the people who were against the war blamed us for taking part in it, and the people who were in favor of the war blamed us for not winning, as if it were our fault.
Exactly. So. And I hope you know that we appreciate your service, Mark. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Sure.
So let's talk about your interest in writing this book. What happened? Was there a moment where you suddenly had an aha moment? Were you reading an old news item or something?
No, I wish it were, but it was, you know, I had just finished my last book, which was a biography of Francis Scott Key. This was back in 2014, and I was looking around for another book. You know, as you mentioned, I'm a Vietnam War veteran. I've written a lot during my journalism career about the Vietnam War and Vietnam veterans, and this is my ninth book, but I hadn't really written a book that had a strong Vietnam War theme, so I always wanted to. And then a friend of mine, who was also an author and a Vietnam vet, was working on a biography. We were working on a proposal to write this biography, and then he didn't do it. And I, you know, when he told me he didn't do it, he said, you know, if you want to go for it, go for it. I said, this is great. So I wrote a proposal, and I got the contract.
So tell me a little bit about Staff Sergeant Barry Sadler. Was he paralyzed?
Yeah. I mean, this happened, you know... before he died, he was shot in Guatemala City. You know, he had this great song, you know, and he had all this popularity, but he got out of the army in 67, thought he could make it in music, and it didn't work. And so he blew all the money, and you know, he had a kind of a rough marriage, and he had a wife and three children, and they were living in Nashville, and things weren't going well, so he moved to Guatemala, to Guatemala City, where, and he had a second act of writing books. You know, he wrote 29 pulp fiction novels.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, 22 of them in a series called Casca, the Eternal Mercenary, about a legendary Roman soldier who lanced Christ on the cross and then was condemned to never die. And so this guy comes back in 22 different books, and they sold well, but he spent the money faster than it came in, and he was living a rough life down there in Guatemala. And one night, this was in September of 88, he was in a taxi cab, and he got shot. He got a bullet through the temple. And the official police report was that he was drunk and he was carrying a gun, and it went off and inadvertently shot himself. The family and friends did not believe that. They think it was a robbery or assassination or whatever. But
right.
He did not die. The family got him out. They hired a Learjet and with a doctor and nurses, and they got him to Nashville, and he was operated on at the VA hospital there, and he recovered from this brain surgery, but he never got out of the hospital, and he was paralyzed. He was practically quadriplegic. Yeah, he could move a little bit of one arm, and it was a very sad ending. He was in the hospital until he died in November of 89. He was
okay, so the shooting that left him partially paralyzed was a year before he died or so?
Yes, correct.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
So the rest of his life earlier, the problems he had earlier were not from the robbery, everything, because I was confused when the robbery happened.
Yeah, no, that was after. Yeah, no, his main problem, I think, you know, from writing his biography, is he had a really rough upbringing. His parents divorced when he was five, and then his father died of cancer, and his mother, you know, let's just say she was not Mrs. America. She just was not a good mother at all. Yeah, she bought Barry and his brother all over the West. She was born in New Mexico and basically grew up in Leadville, Colorado, and she basically ignored the boys and worse. And so he was an admitted juvenile delinquent, but he kind of resurrected himself there by doing a good thing. And you hate to say dropping out of high school is a good thing, but he dropped out at 17 and he joined the Air Force, and he straightened out. You know, he was served honorably for 4 years in the Air Force, got his GED, was in Japan, was a black belt in martial arts, and just really did well, but he didn't want to be in the Air Force, and he got out and then was going back to the road of being a juvenile delinquent again, and then joined the Army, Airborne, and Special Forces.
It seems to me that if you have a hit song and you are Barry Sadler in 1966, while there was a lot of anti-Vietnam War sentiment, that he would have been the perfect spokesman to counter that anti-war sentiment. Did he do any of that? Did he do the talk show circuit, et cetera,
Yes, in spades. In fact, the Army took him off regular duty. It wasn't so much to counter anti-war sentiment, it was to promote the Green Berets and the Army. Because, you know, the Green Berets, you know, had only really officially started in 62, and, you know, special warfare, it was controversial, so they were always very PR-oriented, and here they had a guy with the number one song, right? He looked like a recruiting poster. He was really handsome. He was well-spoken. He was modest. He had come back from Vietnam, where he had been wounded. So they took him off regular duties and sent him around the country from February of 66 to May of 67. So he appeared at dozens and dozens of, you know, state fairs, county fairs, Veterans of Foreign Wars conventions, Doors of the American Revolution, bond rallies, you name it. And the thing of it is, he hated it. He wanted to be a soldier. So that's the reason, and I mentioned earlier, that he got out of the Army as soon as he could in May of 67. So he really wanted to stay in the Army and be a soldier, but he was kind of a victim of his own celebrityhood. You know what I mean? He was.
Yeah, I can see that.
And it seems that his emotional problems from when he was a child might not have even been addressed. They might have been buried, and those issues never really surfaced until after he left the military, and then maybe that was really hard for him to come to grips with.
You know, you're absolutely right, and it was you know, you would think, oh gosh, I get to go to all these places, and you know, people adore me and stuff, and that did happen. But you know, it was the same thing over and over. People asking the same questions over and over again, and you know, he wanted to be a soldier, and I, you know, I'm sorry to say that he you know, he drank to excess, and he kind of made a mess of things.
Was he around for his children, for the raising of his three children?
Not very much, no.
Oh my goodness! It kind of continued. The Ballad of the Green Berets served to generate more enlistment from people. Like it seems like the Green Berets back in the '60s was like Navy SEALs today. It's like he gets a lot of positive press, and I'm guessing because of his song.
That was one reason, and the other thing was, you know, it was President Kennedy was a big backer of the Special Forces of the, you know, the real name is the Special Forces, and that's part of the allure too, is that they become known as the Green Berets, and that was one of Kennedy's things. They were informally wearing the Green Beret, and then he went down to Fort Bragg where the training center was. It was this famous moment in Green Beret history. This was in '61, where he talked to General Yarborough, who was the commanding general, and said, you know, I like these Green Berets, let's make it official, you know. So they were Kennedy saw it as a new way of warfare, you know, unconventional, and so that really gave it a big boost, and Barry's song did too, absolutely. And by the way, it's still very, very popular among Green Berets serving now and veterans. You know, it's played at reunions. I've heard it at Green Berets funerals, and
wow.
You know, yeah, and you know, if I have a Google News alert, you know, on Ballad of the Green Berets, so I get emails whenever it's mentioned, and there are the, you know, internet radio stations that it's played every day. You could hear that song every
day.
Wow!
So who collects the royalties? His children?
You know, it's unclear, and I think it may have lapsed or it went to a music company, but his wife is and children are still alive, and she has not benefited from the song. I'll just put it that way.
Oh, what a shame. That is such a shame.
That's something that we have to change that somehow.
When you were doing your research, did you have flashbacks about your time in Vietnam?
You know, I didn't. I was very lucky. I got drafted into the Army, and I had no control over what job they were going to give me, and they made me a clerk. So I did go to Vietnam 5 months after I was drafted, but I was in a safe area during 1968. I mean, it wasn't fun, but I didn't have any horrible things happen to me. So I feel really lucky in that regard.
So, you know, as an arts editor, I have a question to ask you, just kind of tapping into that part of your brain, if you don't mind.
Sure.
When I was a kid, I used to look at that picture of the drum and fife, the three guys from the Revolutionary War. Okay. And I used to think, isn't it interesting, this is a war, and they're playing music, you know? and then, because I've always loved music, and I've always felt that music moves us one way or another, whether it's to be stronger or to be sentimental, whatever. And from your perspective, as of not only a veteran, but somebody who has obviously a care for the arts, and this song is a great example of that, actually. It is interesting, isn't it, how music and the military seem to work together, depending on the song, I guess, or the type of music.
Yeah. Well, you're right. The military, you know, well, I'll just say, would it surprise you to know that there were Army bands in Vietnam during the war?
Yes, that surprises me. Yeah.
They were. There were. I know guys who served in them who played music there. So they're very well aware. You know, they would have ceremonies, you know, medal ceremonies, medal awarding ceremonies and stuff. I think martial music, you know, has been a part of not just the American military, but other countries too, sure.
Yeah, what was the thing with the Scottish bagpipes? That was part of war. The bagpipe was part of the army in Scotland, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. That I mean, how else would you put up with that sound?
you had written that Barry was running guns in South America and training guerrillas?
Well, that's what he let out. You know, don't forget, when he went down there in 84, there was a lot going on down. Remember the Contras and the Sandinistas, and there was revolution and civil war going on in Guatemala, Nicaragua, El Salvador, and Honduras. And he led on, and Guatemala City was kind of like a haven for mercenaries and gun runners and so on. And he told people he was. There was an article in Soldier of Fortune where he even gave details. But, you know, I talked to a lot of people, including the founder and publisher of Soldier of Fortune, who told me that, and friends who visited, and, you know, he basically was down there writing his books and doing a lot of drinking and running around. I will tell you, though, that he also had medical supplies there, his own, and on his own, he treated Guatemalan Indians. You know, he'd go out and, you know, do a little country medicine out there. So
wow.
it wasn't all negative, but it was pretty wild.
I found the book on Amazon. You've got 5-star reviews. How about that? Look at this. Oh, my gosh. I think you have nothing but 5-star. Oh, a couple of knuckleheads gave you 4 stars, but you have 5.
But I'll take it.
That's pretty good. Yeah. Wow.
Since you were able to do all this research and maybe had open arms from the people that knew him personally, what kind of a flavor did you go away with every time you interviewed somebody?
Well, you're right. I mean, I did. I talked to 70 people, nearly all of whom knew him. His wife was very cooperative. I talked to her for hours and hours. His children would not talk to me. But
really?
Yeah, for whatever reason, I mean, I tried, but
yeah.
I think I got a fairly good picture. I mean, he had a lot of friends. I talked to a lot of his Nashville friends, and they're very loyal to him. They said he was really funny, one of the funniest guys they knew. He was very loyal to his friends. A lot of the money that he blew on his friends, you know. But you know, he had, like you said, I don't think he ever overcame that rough childhood, and there was that drinking, and it wasn't...
You know, in today's world, we are very much aware of PTSD, and I'm not a psychiatrist, and I'm not even attempting to... Anyway, but I just have a thought. I wonder if, perhaps, there isn't something to the whole PTSD thing that may not necessarily have to have a traumatic event. Maybe just the idea of going to war is traumatic enough for many people, and it can change you.
Yeah, you know, other people have mentioned that to me, and also, I'm not a psychologist either, but, you know, I think if Barry did have PTSD, it had to do with his childhood, you know, that rough, I didn't even get into the details.
Sounds like it, yeah.
And also, I think the song, what happened to him, it wasn't traumatic to have the number one song and to get all this money. By the way, he got $500,000 in royalties the first 6 months alone.
Whoa.
His sergeant salary was $350 a month at the time.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, right.
So that's not traumatic, I don't think. But what happened afterward, I mean, you know, he blew it all by 73. So I think that you know, that experience of, you know, the other thing is he really loved the Army, but he felt really let down by the Army when they wouldn't let him be a soldier and they made him go around the country and do all this.
That
stuff.
Is interesting.
Oh,
marketing,
gosh.
even the Army has interest in marketing. Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Well, they didn't. They never had a better marketing tool than the Ballad of the Green Beret, and now you've breathed new life into it by giving us some insight into the man who made that song. Go ahead, Rob.
Was he a doctor before he was a medic?
No. He had a high school GED. By the way, you have to pass a series of really difficult, you know, intelligent tests to get into Green Beret Medic School, and he did. Most of the other guys were college guys. And one guy told me, who went to Harvard, it was the hardest classroom work he ever did, because in 1 year, they had this medic training that, you know, qualified them to do everything from, you know, pull teeth to birth babies and everything in between. So,
gosh.
Wow.
Yeah.
I found the book on Amazon. I'm sure it's everywhere else. But let me get a website if you have one that you want us to go to, Mark.
Yeah, it's my name. Yeah, markleepson.com, and it's spelled M-A-R-C. L-E-E-P-S-O-N.
By the way, I'd love to read what you wrote about Francis Scott Key, too. That's another fascinating person we don't know a whole lot about, right?
Yeah, well, listen, I'd be happy to come back on the show and talk about Key, because that's another thing, you know one thing about him, right?
That he wrote
the Star-Spangled Banner.
Right.
But he turns out he was a really important player in the early republic, man. Big lawyer in D.C.
Yep. Wow, I had no clue. Wow. Really interesting stuff. I know that a lot of our listeners were looking forward to this interview. Mark Leepson, L-E-P-S-O-N, if you're looking up his website, markleepson.com. And the book that he's talking about right now, The Ballad of the Green Beret, The Life and Wars of Staff Sergeant Barry Sadler, From the Vietnam War and Pop Stardom to Murder and an Unsolved Violent Death. Thank you, Mark. Thank you for being on the show with us today.
Thank you, guys. Terrific.
All right, we'll be right back.
Men who mean just what they say, the brave men of the Green Beret.